This talk is, as was introduced, the idea is that to show some interesting pieces of Ruby core and standard library, to hopefully use simple but not simplistic examples. And the main problem with examples is that the people who write them are usually so much into them that they make them very interesting to themselves, but not really readable. So please, if there's anything that is too complicated or that you would like me to explain a bit more or stop at some slide, just shout at me and I will stop or go back to a slide. So my name is Peter. I have no clue how to pronounce my nickname, so I'm totally fine with people mispronouncing my last name. I work at the university. I'm the CSO of a Ruby and Rails consultancy and apparently JavaScript recently. We do Ember. So if you want any help with that, please let me know. And and at the university, when you work at a public university, at your department, you usually have some servers. And because you cannot really employ dedicated DevOps people, you will find just the least incompetent person on your team to run those servers, which for some reason happens to be me. And I'm so clueless when it comes to a Puppet or Chef that I decided to use Ansible. And I orchestrate our servers with Ansible, which is apparently the right term to say. Ansible is a two-year-old application that basically lets you do this. It basically lets you describe how a server is supposed to work. This is for one of our servers. And the main idea behind it is you write a script how the server is supposed to behave at the end, and it makes sure it behaves like this. So you can rerun it. It's independent in that if there are some packages already installed, it keeps them installed, and so on. And this is the typical output, which basically means refresh the package cache, upgrade packages if there is any bash package on your system, probably upgrade it if it's older than an hour, and install all of the funny packages that you're supposed to use. And this is somewhat of a bland UI in that it basically prints out those things with the stars and so on and so forth. But if you happen to have installed on your system a 15-year-old program that is called Kausei, and that's exactly what it says, then suddenly, without any changes to Ansible, the output of Ansible starts to look like this. You have lovely ASCII art, cows saying all of those things. And first, this is surprisingly funny, especially if it's, you know, 3 in the morning and you have yet another bash upgrade because, you know, last week was really, really fun. And the second thing is, if you have this environmental variable set to random, Ansible cow selection random, obviously, like, what could be a better name, then the cow is actually randomized, which means that every single server gets a different output. So if you have all of your different servers in different tabs and keep them rerunning the upgrades every hour, for example, then you can see that the different servers are being upgraded with the different cow images. So Kausei, as I said, is a, I think the not only the initial release was 15 years ago, I think it's still the version that we all use. The way it works is basically a Kausei program that you pass a string and it says that string that you pass to it. And if you want to have a different cow or bunny in this case, you just pass the dash F flag that takes a name of a cow file, and that cow file is used as a template to render it. As you can see in this case, when you are using shell, it's really important to get all the quotation marks right, because if we got the quotation marks wrong, or if there was a command inside hiding inside of this string, then we might involuntarily run that command. So can we call Kausei from Ruby? This is a Ruby conference, so let's actually get some Ruby on the slides. Yes, of course. There is a system method that is defined on the kernel module, which means it's available everywhere, that takes a string and runs that string, executes that command. In this case, there is a DAG that says attack surface intensifies. The problem with this is that if you construct this string like this, like you take the text from some outside source, hopefully it's your own data, but maybe it's some user-submitted data, you might want to run it like this, and it will still work. The thing is, what if we make the text a little bit funnier? Let's just, you know, add a semicolon and some random characters at the end of it. What will happen if we run it? I'm not sure. I'm not pasting the output because I didn't set up a virtual environment just to test this one out. But basically, the thing is, you should really be careful about sanitizing your input. Or you should know that the system takes not only a single string to run, but it actually can take any number of strings you want. And the first one will be the command that you're supposed to run, and all the others will be parameters. And if you do it like this, then this is what it expands to, obviously, like causa-f, duck. These are all separate strings. And this actually works. Like, system is clever enough to sanitize or escape the last part and not let you wreak havoc to your own files. The problem with the system command, though, is that it actually runs it in a subshell, so there is no way of capturing the output of the system call. If you try to assign it to anything and then print it, this is just an echo, then the echo will actually still run. You will still get the output from the echo, and the result of the system method is just a Boolean that says whether that was a successful run or not. Just a Boolean that says true or false, whether the command succeeded. So can we capture the output? Is there a way in Ruby to capture the output? Well, there is. There is a kernel backtick method that can be used to construct something like this. So just a string inside of backticks. It looks like a special Ruby syntax, but it's not. It's just like the Ruby parser finds that there is a matching backtick and just takes this all, turns it into a string, and passes it to the backtick kernel method. So we can, for example, redefine it. And the problem with this is that this is exactly the same problem as with the original system call that we use with just a single string. Like, I don't know whether you know what bash profile is. It's basically a file with subsequent commands that set up your bash environment. And bash history is a file that contains, for example, the last 100 or the last 1,000 commands that you run in bash. Source is a bash command that runs all of the lines in that file. So if you source bash profile, it will set up your bash profile. If instead you source bash history, you will run your last 1,000 commands. Probably one of them is rm-rf star, and it runs them in the context of the directory you are now. So if you have this, the first thing you might notice is that the quote is missing, those two parts that are in the backticks. And the second part is there are those two lines that basically say you're super lucky because your default shell is sh, which doesn't have the source command. If your default shell was bash, first, you have had a lot of fun last week. Second, you would have even more fun because you would be the person that says, what happened to my system today? The thing is, like, whatever is in your bash history, like, it's you know best, right? So is there a way to make backticks, which are super useful because backticks allow us to get the output of the command into a variable, so back to our Ruby, is there a way to make them safe? And one of the standard libraries is the shellwords library that is 16 years old now, and what it can do is it can escape a text in a shell-safe manner. So we can pass the text to escape method for the shellwords module, and then we can pass it to the backticks, and it will actually work properly. So if you ever do any kind of passing strings to shell, especially if they are user-provided, first, you shouldn't do this, even if it's just, you know, somebody uploads a file and we want to preserve the name of that file before we mangle it through image magic. Be very, very cautious before you pass the name of the file to your image magic instance. If you have to do this, if you have to preserve the name, use shell words to escape it. But the thing with POSIX shells is that not only the output, the standard output is what is interesting. There are also things like standard error, standard input, which you might want to feed into the command. And for this, there is, again, a standard library. This one is a bit younger. It's only 15 years old. And one of the methods that once you require OPEN3, you have the OPEN3 module. And one of the methods is capture3, which allows you to manipulate all of the, so it returns the output, standard error. It returns a status object that tells you how it went. That is not a simple Boolean, but it's actually a status object. And if you want to, one of the parameters you can pass is the standard input. So this works. You get a very nice koala that says something. And the thing is that it also works like the system method. It's that if you pass those as separate strings, then this will actually escape them properly, and we won't get the contents of our etc password file concatenated to the output. We will actually just get it into this parameter properly escaped. And this shows also that the status is an actual status object that you can send the success method, and it will tell you that this is true. So it's not a Boolean, it's an object that you can also, for example, ask for the numeric value of the output. So if there are different kinds of errors, they're usually in Bash or in POSIX compliant programs, they are usually signified by a different output error numbers. Okay, but the thing with standard input, standard output, and standard error is that they are really streams. And it would be cool if we could operate them like on any other I/O object in Ruby, and we can also still do this without reaching for any kind of external gem. There is a popen3 method that we pass what we want to as the command, and we pass it a block with four parameters. The first one is standard input stream, the second standard output, the third standard error, and the fourth is a thread that will run this command. So this runs the command in a separate thread. So first you get the control back much sooner, and you get actually stream objects. So you can put S into the streams, separate lines, then you can close this, the input stream. At that point, COSEI will say, okay, so this is everything that people wanted me to make the COSEI. And then you can read from the output stream. And also, the thread is actually where the code executes. So you can wait for the thread's value, and this is the success object. So this will make the Darth Vader koala say, it can be a little bit difficult to secure the connections, as decided using JSONP and MD5. And again, as you can see, the status object is returned, and it has the status method that returns a true in this case. Okay, but if we have different kind of terminals, usually the default terminal that you open is probably 24 by 80 characters or 25 lines by 80 columns. But people can make their terminals more narrow, and it would be nice if we didn't print very wide cows into narrow terminals, because then they would get wrapped. Is there a way to peek at the co files, see what the templates are, and maybe find the most narrow co file that we can use? So first, let's peek at a single co file. For this, you could just use the regular approach where we keep the paths to the files in strings, and then we use the file open stuff to manipulate them. But there is the path name library that is surprisingly young. It's only 11 years old. But it's there, and it's my really pet peeve that people should use it much more. There is a great article from Arne that describes all of the nice things about the path name that is linked at the end of this talk. But just to show you some things that the path name objects can do. First, there's a glob method that you can pass a glob that says, basically, give me all of the paths to all of the co files. And if we get the first one, first we have an object that represents a path, but it's not a string. So it represents both the path and, to some extent, the file itself. We can actually do path.read on the first object, and we can see that it looks like this. This, if you are unlucky to recognize it on the first sight, is a Perl file. And it's a template for one of the COSEIs that basically has some comments and then has a bit of Perl code that is a here doc, which is those long strings that have a starting identifier and ending identifier, and between those, they're basically a long string. So first, we shouldn't really try to parse or even mangle Perl files with Ruby, because that's obviously wrong, so let's do it. Let's start by dropping the dollar variables first. Well, it's super simple. We just gsub from anything that starts with a dollar and is followed by any characters or an underscore. And if we do so, it starts to look surprisingly like an elephant that is eaten by a snake, which obviously is one of the co-files that you can use and that your server can communicate with you by using this and transible saying, like, I just eaten an elephant and also upgraded Bash again. So can we keep only the here doc? Can we only print the here doc? Is there a Ruby construct that would allow us to print only the stuff between these identifiers. Does anybody know what's the most obscure Ruby, like core Ruby feature that could allow us to do this? There is a feature in Ruby that every single time a new Ruby release, like 1.8, 1.9, 2.0, 2.1 is proposed, is let's drop the flip-flops. Let's not have flip-flops anymore. They are things from, you know, old time, past. It's from cargo culting Perl, basically. And there's always somebody who says, no, I have a use case for flip-flops that really is good enough to keep them. I was trying to come up with the use case. As you can see, there's some preparation people have to do to make flip-flops work in your mind again. But I actually came up with the use case, and it's basically this. If we want to print all the lines between this here doc, like this delimiter and this delimiter, we can use the flip-flop operator, which basically is says, put as the line and remove all the Perl variables if it's one of the lines between a line that contains EO and the line that is EO something by itself. I learned the hard way that not all of the here docs in CowSay are EOC. Some of them are EOF. Technically, this identifier can be anything, so you really shouldn't try to mangle Perl files with Ruby, but this is good enough in practice, which is one of the things we learned that, you know, good solutions that work 90% of the time actually work. Great solutions that work 100% of the time but are never completed are not as good. So the way flip-flop works is basically you put it in an if conditional. It looks like a range, but it's not. And it basically will do this. It like won't do this up until this is met. Then once this is true, it will keep running this on a line, in this case, line by line basis, up until this is true. Once this is true, it will stop running this. Again, as I said, a drink or two is highly recommended before you try to wrap your mind around the flip-flops. OK. Can we find the best call file for narrow terminals? Can we actually also show that Ruby can be used in a functional way? And can we do this by still mangling Perl files with Ruby? Again, please don't do this. So let's. Because the flip-flop operator is somewhat gnarly, it's good to move it away to some place, ideally some other file. So let's put a lambda that takes a single argument, which is, in this case, a line, and put this whole flip-flop thing into that lambda. And that lambda basically says, if we run this lambda over and over again, once this happens, this gets executed, and it will, again, keep being executed until this is true. So this is basically a lambda that, if you execute it over a collection, it will, the moment this is true in that collection, it starts returning up until this is true. So let's now take all of the call files. Let's map them by the redlines method, which basically means turn an array of path names into an array of arrays of lines from every element of this map will be an array of lines from that file. And then let's run this lambda on each of those arrays. Let's drop the nils. So now we have an arrays of lines that are only from inside of the here doc. And then let's find the path name that has this returning the smallest number. And this returns the size of the longest line. So basically, for every here doc like this, translated into an array of lines, we find the longest line. We decide that's the number of characters is the width of the call file. And then we find the most narrow call file in our system. And it happens to be run, which is really, really thin. So it will fit even if you have like 15 terminals, very narrow ones. And of course, what I'm trying to show here indirectly is that you can chain. This is all one call that is basically take a glob, then call a map on it, then call a map on it, then call a minby on it. This will return an array of lines. And put s, when it's called an array of lines, just concatenates them. But every single line of these lines ends with a new line. So concatenating them would actually create a string that is that looks like this. So you can do functional programming in Ruby. Arne tomorrow will tell you why probably you shouldn't. If we have this, it's very tempting to also find the widest call in our system, and all that is needed is replacing this min by a max by, and if we do this, we see that this turtle is the absolutely widest call file that we have. Okay, so this is all cool, right? If we have a console that is wide enough, we can create, for example, a dragon call file that says the real meaning of Halloween gets lost in all the costumes and marketing. Most people don't even know Jesus fought a dragon, let alone why. The problem is, when we do this, and we set it, you can see that the text is wrapped at 40 characters, because that's what call say does by default. It would be cool if we could use all of the width of our console and just wrap it to just wrap the text to be as wide as possible, but thanks to this, maybe shorter. We can do this. There's a dash W flag to call say. We just need to find the width of the console. Again, this is possible without any gems. There is an IO console library that seems like it got into Ruby core, like the distribution, only 4 years ago. I'm not sure whether it was imported from elsewhere. I wasn't able to figure it out, but it seems like the oldest commit is from 4 years ago. And what we can do once we require IO console is the IO module gets a console method that has a win size method that returns in a very good basic old Ruby manner just an array with two numbers, and you're expected to know that the first number is the number of rows and the second number is the number of columns. So if we now take the last number from this array, which is the number of columns, subtract 4 so we have some space for the borders of the balloon and the spaces, then we can wrap the text to whatever size the console we currently have. So the last thing I want to show from the user-related or the system-related stuff in the Solar library is an example why the libraries in the Solar library are very different sometimes. This is an example of using Etsy library. This is a quote that I really, really hope is made up, but I've seen enough of systems to be scared that it might be true. Please choose another password to create your account. The password you attempted is already used by user Jenkins. I can see how people end up with this kind of solution. Like, okay, I hashed your password, but there's another hash like this, and it belongs to Jenkins. So please use a different one, because we don't want to have two hashes that look the same. Okay, so let's say we want to display this message, but depending on whether the user is in the admin group or not, we want to use a different call file. And we can do this. The Etsy library is, again, 16 years old. There is a very nice and nicely named getLogin method that returns the currently logged user, logged in user. But there's also this wonderfully named getGrNum method that takes a string and returns an object that represents a group entry. The thing is, you cannot check. If you have a user, you cannot ask the Etsy module what groups the user is in. But if you have a group, you can ask what users are in that group. If you know how POSIX works, it stems down to basically parsing two text files, and the group file actually says who belongs there. So the getGrNum method returns a group object that has a wonderful mem method that you have to memorize that returns members. These are not actual user objects. They are actually strings. So if that array includes our user, let's use the tags call file. If not, let's use the www one. And this example also shows that as many stuff in the Solar library, if you require shell words, it will silently extend all of the strings with a new method, because that what was considered good practice back in 16 years ago, probably. Okay, this makes a very nice tag saying this thing. So to recap all of the shell stuff, if you want to run something that is you're not interested in its I/O, then just use kernel system, but please use separate arguments. If you want to have only simple I/O, use the backtick, but please satinize. Sanitize. Sanitize the input with shell words. If you want to have input-output error streams and a separate thread, just use Open3. If you want to have even higher control, there's a Pty standard library that is 15 years old and the shell standard library that is 13 years old, and they are both also enable you to run this. Please use pathname everywhere. If you have any kind of strings, please use pathname. It will fall back to be a good replacement for a string in most of the contexts where you use strings now. And if you want terminal size, just use IO console. Okay, the last part of this talk is about my favorite standard library. It's really confusing that it's a library of libraries. So let's say we want to, let's say the cosi was really an expensive operation. What can we do to not really stress our system when we want to generate a lot of cos and we want to generate it a lot for a very long time? Well, we could cache it. Like, the problem is the cache could get large. This is not a web application, so we won't get the process killed anyway in a couple of minutes. So we can actually can have a long-running process, in which case the cache growing large might be a problem. But you know, what can be simpler than cache invalidation? Like, maybe naming things is simpler, but cache invalidation is trivial. So let's try to do this. Let's try we want to have this API. We want to have a co-cache object that we can call fetch on it, and we pass a funny text, and we want, for example, a duck to say this funny text. And if we had two different texts, like node.jk or ttyhulls, then we want our system to work like this. First, we want to, the first time we ask for, in this case, node.jk, we want this to tell us on the debug output that it generates this cow and then prints a duck, obviously. The next time we have a new string, we also want to obviously generate it. But if we reuse some of the text, we want to see that we have the output, but we don't have the debug line. So basically, we want to have create a cache that actually shows us that it works as a cache. We could do it like this. We could say, OK, I know all of the libraries. There is a forwardable that is 13 years old, very good library. So let's delegate our square brackets to some internal hash that we'll call hash cache, because we did it late at night. And because we know we are really on top, and we know in Ruby 2.0 you have this percentage I construct that lets you construct an array of symbols. So if you want an array of symbols, let's use percent I. Our team will love it. Like, the next person who tries to read this will come to us and say, thank you for enlightening me. I will now use percent I everywhere. Then we show that we really know Ruby, and we will alias method fetch to that square brackets. And then we'll have a couple of private methods, one that generates the cow using a logger. Logger is also something that comes from a standard library, is 11 years old, and gives you a like logger new. You pass it a stream object, and it will print into that stream object whenever you call log debug, just like raised logger, basically, if you know that. And we can also show that, we want to return a logger here, but when we also need to adjust it, so we'll use tap, which is this fancy method that made its way from Rails to Ruby core. So first, when it was only in Rails, it was absolutely the worst idea ever, but then it was translated to Ruby core, and everybody said, okay, that's actually very useful, thanks. So this is one way of implementing it. The other way that I would really strongly suggest is that there are times when being explicit makes things simpler, and your code will be read many more times than it is being written. So let's actually do it a bit simpler. Let's create a very simple hash. So this hash worked in a way that it was initialized with a block, and the block is called whenever there's a missing key. So we basically offloaded all of the missing cow generation to this hash, and whenever there was a missing string, then this hash would generate it. But we can make it much more explicit and simpler. Let's say that our fetch method will try to fetch this from the hash, and if it's missing, it will generate it. As you can see, the forwardable library is gone, the delegate method is gone, the alias method is gone. It's maybe less fancy, maybe less, I've been doing this for many, many years, but actually much more readable. Please do try whether being explicit is not sometimes actually simpler and better. So we have this. We run this, it actually works. The problem is, as I said, this cache will grow forever. If there was a way to expire it easily, for example, whenever we actually need some memory. So if there was a way to make those cows automatically expire whenever the garbage collector is run because we run out of memory. There is. The weakref is my favorite standard library. And once we require it, it's one of the oldest ones. It's 16 years old. And it allows us to wrap any object into a weakref. And the way it works, the object once wrapped in a weakref still has all the same API. The weakref will forward all of the calls that are made to weakref to that object below it, but it, while still keeping a reference to that object, and the question for you is how it does it, it still keeps a reference to the object, but it will let the garbage collector garbage collect that object whenever it needs to. So if we do this, whenever we have a cache miss, we generate a new cow and save it, but wrapped in a weakref, then we can try to run this, which is fetch and generate the first one, fetch and generate the second one. This one shouldn't need generating, but then we use the run, we run the garbage collector, so this call should regenerate the cow for the string, because now our cache should be busted and empty. And we try to run it, and this actually means it works. It generates the first cow, prints it, generates the second one, prints it, takes this one from the cache, so there's no debug line that says it generates it, but then it runs the garbage collector and tries to fetch this cow, which is now missing. And the weakref says there's an invalid reference, probably recycled. Probably the object that has this cow that was wrapped in the weakref got recycled by that garbage collector call. And of course, we need to handle this, and the way to handle this is instead of basically saying that if there is a cow with that key, just return it, we check whether it's there and whether I think it might be the only method that weakref adds is a weakref alive method that basically checks whether its object actually exists. So if it's in the hash cache and the reference is alive, it wasn't garbage collected, then return it. Otherwise, so if it's missing or it got recycled, regenerate it, wrap it in another weak reference, and save it into the hash. And it works now. The first one is generated, second one is generated. This is pulled out of the cache. Here, the garbage collector runs, and here, again, we need to regenerate the cow and have it here. So the question for you is, weakref is a library written in Ruby. How is it possible that a library written in pure Ruby that is not a C extension can work like this? Have a reference to another object, keep the reference somehow, and at the same time let the garbage collector recycle that object. And the way garbage collector works, if you don't know, is that it recycles objects that are not referenced by anything else. So how is it possible that weakref keeps a reference to another object but lets that object be garbage collected? Okay, to wrap up the talk, the title of this talk is really, really bad, but I was asked by the organizers at some point, could you please really, really provide a title for this talk? So I decided I will just reuse those words and mangle them behind recognition. But those words, strong opinions weakly held by Paul Safo, who at that time was director for Institute for the Future at Palo Alto, I think, is, in my opinion, a very good guiding motto for doing a lot of things. He coined it when he thought about predicting what will happen. And his reasoning was, try to have gut feeling predictions. If you can't make any better founded predictions, go with them, but be very open about adjusting your opinions when the facts change or new facts arrive. So do have strong opinions, but hold them weakly. Be open to changing your opinions. And the thing I try to convey in this talk is that there are cases where you might want to use standard libraries and actually they might be good enough. It's good to know what Ruby brings you out of the box. It's good to know how you can use Ruby. It's good to know that, you know, I can never pronounce it properly. Triskaidekaphobiacs are presumably upset that although 13 untrust appears to succeed and reinforce their beliefs, the state doesn't stick, 13 untrusted subsequently returns false. Similarly, logicians and cynics alike must respectively rejoice and despair that true untrust untrusted is perpetually false. These are probably Ruby calls that you might have not seen before, but I brought it not only because it's very good for a speaker to have, you know, good feelings in the audience at the end of the talk because it makes the talk look much better than it really was, but also because What I want to convey is that there are a lot of things in Ruby core that are there for a reason that might not be very often used, but the reason why they are there might be interesting to look into. So your homework, please try to figure out how weakref can possibly work, how it is possible that a Ruby library creates objects that can hold references to other objects that can be garbage collected. Once you figure it out or want to cheat, go to this website. There are wonderful posts on standard library. One of them explains how weakref works. There are RNS posts at SitePoint. One of them explains how pathname works and all of its APIs. There is this Ruby standard library account that is run by some very lazy person that hasn't been posting for a long time. But hopefully, if we can all shame them into reviving this account, then we can possibly, probably bask in the glory of Ruby stuff again. Of course, probably that person can also take suggestions. There was a very nice presentation, Stop Reinventing the Wheel, that had a very distanced view of standard library, reasons why you can use certain libraries, why you probably shouldn't use others and go for the gems. There is a series of blog posts, 1,000 ways to start subprocesses in Ruby. That is, as it says, 3 blog posts with all of those things, if that was the part that piqued your interest in this talk. And finally, if you have a spare $9 a month, or you can cut one coffee a week from your life, please, please consider subscribing to Avdigrim's Ruby Tapas. These are screencasts that appear twice a week, 5-minute long screencasts that shows very nifty things from Ruby's standard library, some very nice gems. And Avdi also created the CowSays website that is basically a web UI for the CowSay program, but also is open source, so we can see how it works. I would like to thank you very much. The slides are here with all the links clickable. This is me online, and I hope you enjoyed this talk. Thank you.